In previous session, we have studied about two important nucleophilic substitution mechanisms. The first one is SN1 mechanism and the second one is SN2 mechanism. In today's session, we shall talk about the stereochemical aspects during nucleophilic substitution mechanisms. Before going to the stereochemical aspects of these mechanisms, we have to be clear with certain terminologies used in stereochemistry. The first terminology we consider is plane polarized light, about which you have already studied in detail in physics. Just to give an introduction, I am going to consider ordinary light, where you have vibrations in all possible directions perpendicular to the direction of propagation. When this ordinary light is passed through certain crystals like Nicol prism, you know, Nicol prism is actually made up of calcium carbonate crystalline modification called calcite. And when this ordinary light passes through Nicol prism and you analyze the emerging light, it has all its vibrations confined to one particular plane. And this light is called plane polarized light. The next terminology we consider is optical activity. The second terminology we consider is optical activity and optically active substances. In this case, I have considered aqueous solution of glucose. I pass plane polarized light through it, and when you analyze the emerging light, it is observed that plane polarized light is rotated towards the right, or it is rotated in clockwise direction. In the same way, if you consider aqueous solution of fructose, it is observed that the plane polarized light will be rotated towards the left or in the anti-clockwise direction. And this property of substances in their solution form to rotate the plane polarized light either in the clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction is called optical activity, and such substances are called optically active substances. I want to measure and detect optical activity. For that purpose, we make use of a device called polarimeter. Or in other words, polarimeter is a device used to detect optical activity and measure it. And in the previous heading, I told you certain substances rotate the plane of polarized light in the clockwise direction or towards the right when they are in solution state. Such substances are called dextrorotatory substances. I gave the example of glucose. On the other hand, when you consider aqueous solution of fructose, I told you plane polarized light will be rotated in anti-clockwise direction or towards the left, and such substances are called levorotatory substances. And these dextrorotatory substances are denoted by D or plus, while levorotatory substances are denoted by L or minus. When we talk about optical isomers, they will have same molecular formula, same structural formula, but they differ only with respect to the direction of rotation of plane polarized light. And such compounds are called optical isomers, and the phenomenon is called optical isomerism. In other words, optical isomers are compounds having the same molecular formula, same structural formula, but differ with respect to direction of rotation of plane polarized light. The next terminology we are going to consider is plane of symmetry, or is also called sigma plane or mirror plane. In order to explain this, let me consider the structure of ethene. I will consider an imaginary plane which bisects the molecule, and after bisecting it, if you consider one half of it, it will be the mirror image of the other half and vice versa. And such imaginary plane is called plane of symmetry, or is called sigma plane. So what is sigma plane or plane of symmetry? It is an imaginary plane which bisects the molecule in such a way that each half is the mirror image of the other half. Next terminology we consider is asymmetric carbon, which is also called chiral carbon, or it is called stereocenter. To explain this, let us consider this example. This is a carbon atom. You know, there are four valencies for a particular carbon atom. And here, these four valencies are satisfied by different groups. And this carbon, which is connected to four different substituents, here hydrogen atom, chlorine atom, fluorine atom and methyl group, all of them are different, and such a carbon atom which is connected to four different substituents is termed as asymmetric carbon atom. Now the question is, if suppose a carbon atom is connected by means of double bond, so how do we check whether it's an asymmetric carbon atom or not? For that particular purpose, let's consider this example. You have carbon atom here, let us say CH3, and we have C double bond OH. What I have to do, I have to check whether this aldehyde carbon atom is asymmetric or not. The problem here is, this carbon atom is connected to one oxygen atom by means of double bond. So how to check whether it is asymmetric or not? In such cases, what we have to do is, we have to consider the same atom again, connected to the same carbon atom by means of two single bonds. Or in other words, the same molecule can be represented like, you have CH3C, single bond O, single bond O, and single bond H. When you write like this, you know now the two bonds are satisfied by same atom. That's why this carbon atom is non-asymmetric carbon atom. So I repeat, whenever there is a double bond, the same group has to be written two times, connected by means of single bonds. And in such case, you come to know that the two bonds are satisfied by same substituent. In such case, the carbon atom becomes non-asymmetric carbon atom. So next terminology we consider is chiral objects. In order to understand this concept, I will consider human hand. This is my left hand, and its mirror image will be my right hand. I want to check whether my left hand has a non-superimposable mirror image or not. For that purpose, what I have to do, either I rotate the mirror image by 180 and place the object on its mirror image, or I will rotate the object by 180 and place it over the mirror image. In both the cases, you observe that the left hand does not have a superimposable mirror image, or my left hand has non-superimposable mirror image. That's why human hand is an example for chiral objects. I want to extend the concept of chirality to organic molecule. For that purpose, I have considered the three-dimensional structure of 2-propanol. In this structure, you can make out that the carbon-hydrogen bond and carbon-OH bond lie in the plane of the board. One methyl group is projected out of the plane, another methyl group is projected into the plane. When you consider the mirror image, you can make out that the group which is closer to the mirror appears closer to the mirror in the mirror image. Now, as I told you, if I want to check whether the object has a non-superimposable mirror image or not, I am going to rotate the mirror image through 180 degree about carbon-OH bond. When you do that, you can make out that this methyl group, which is projected out of the plane, after rotating it through 180 degree, that goes into the plane. In the same way, the methyl group, which is projected into the plane in the mirror image, you rotate it through 180 degree, that gets projected out of the plane. Now, I'm going to place the object, that is 2-propanol, on the mirror image after rotating it through 180 degree. You can make out that CHCOH and also CCH3 and CCH3 perfectly get superimposed on this particular structure. It's for this reason we say 2-propanol has a superimposable mirror image. What is the reason for that? You just find out whether the carbon atoms in this molecule are asymmetric or non-asymmetric carbon atoms. I'll come to this carbon atom. You can make out that out of the four bonds, the two bonds are satisfied by the same group. So this carbon atom is not an asymmetric carbon atom. Similarly, you can easily make out that these two carbon atoms are also non-asymmetric, as these carbon atoms, there are three hydrogen atoms connected by means of single bond. In other words, in this molecule, there are no asymmetric carbon atoms. That is why the object has a superimposable mirror image. I'll extend the same concept to the next molecule. It is 2-butanol. Consider the three-dimensional structure of 2-butanol. Here, one CH3 group is projected out of the plane. The ethyl group is projected into the plane. So this will be its mirror image. I'll rotate this mirror image through 180 degree about carbon-OH bond. I will get this structure. Now I'm going to compare the object molecule with the mirror image after rotating it through 180 degree. You can make out that CH and COH will get superimposed on this CH and COH. But if you look at the ethyl group, here it is projected into the plane, whereas in this structure it is projected out of the plane. Similarly, you consider methyl group. In the object molecule, it is projected out of the plane, whereas in this structure, it is projected into the plane. Or in other words, because of this ethyl and methyl group, the object is non-superimposable on its mirror image. Now, when you look at this molecule, you know, this carbon atom is going to be asymmetric. How can I say it's asymmetric? These four bonds are satisfied by four different substituents: hydrogen, OH, ethyl, and methyl. What about these two these three carbon atoms? They are non-asymmetric carbon atom. In other words, two butanol molecule has only one asymmetric carbon atom, and it has a non-superimposable mirror image. And such molecules which have non-superimposable mirror images are called what are known as chiral molecule, or they are also called dissymmetric molecule. When you consider this example, you know, this carbon atom is asymmetric carbon atom. This carbon atom is also asymmetric carbon atom. So there are two asymmetric carbon atoms. But when you look at the structure, it is possible to pass a plane of symmetry like this. When you do this, you can make out that the lower half is the mirror image of the upper half, and vice versa. It's for this reason this particular molecule is said to be a superimposable molecule. So from this example, it's very clear that in spite of possessing two asymmetric carbon atoms, the molecule is a chiral. It is because of the presence of sigma plane or plane of symmetry. When you consider this molecule, you know, this carbon atom is asymmetric, this carbon atom is asymmetric. But when you look at the molecule, it's very clear that there is no plane of symmetry. Because of that, this molecule has a non-superimposable mirror image. So with these discussions, it's very clear that whenever a molecule does not have any asymmetric carbon atom, the molecule can never be chiral. If the molecule has only one asymmetric carbon atom, the molecule must be chiral. And if a molecule contains more than one asymmetric carbon atoms, it may be or may not be chiral. So this is what is very, very important when we talk about optical activity. The most important condition for optical activity is the molecule as a whole must be chiral or dissymmetric. I repeat, if a molecule has to be optically active, the molecule as a whole must be chiral or dissymmetric. What is the meaning of that? The molecule must not possess any plane of symmetry, and it must have a non-superimposable mirror image. Let us consider optical isomerism in lactic acid. The structure of lactic acid is represented here. This is the only one asymmetric carbon atom that is present in the molecule. And I told you, whenever there is one asymmetric carbon atom, the molecule must have a non-superimposable mirror image. That I have represented in three dimension like this. So this is the carbon atom, which is asymmetric carbon atom, and this is going to be its non-superimposable mirror image. If this molecule rotates the plane of polarized light in the clockwise direction, this molecule rotates the plane of polarized light in the anti-clockwise direction through the same angle. And these stereoisomers, which are related to one another as non-superimposable mirror images, are called enantiomers . They are also called enantiomorphs. Or they are also called antipoles. These two are enantiomers of lactic acid. I repeat, if this molecule is D-lactic acid, this has to be L-lactic acid, and vice versa. If suppose this is L-lactic acid, this has to be D-lactic acid. Now, so what are enantiomers then? Enantiomers are stereoisomers which are related to one another as non-superimposable mirror images. Let us talk about these two enantiomers. They have identical physical properties. When I say that, if I compare their melting points, boiling points, refractive index, solubility, etc., they are one and the same. If I consider their chemical properties, again they are identical, provided the other substance with which it reacts should also be a chiral. What is the only difference between these two molecules? They differ only with respect to direction of rotation of plane polarized light. Let us study about the next terminology, racemic mixture or racemic modification. To explain that, I will consider a mixture containing 50% of D-lactic acid and remaining 50% is L-lactic acid. You know that the 50% of D-lactic acid rotates the plane polarized light in the clockwise direction. At the same time, remaining 50% is L-lactic acid rotates the plane of polarized light in the anti-clockwise direction. So, if you consider the resultant rotation, it becomes zero because optical rotation caused by D-lactic acid is perfectly compensated by optical rotation caused by L-lactic acid. That's why the entire mixture becomes optically inactive, and this optically inactive mixture is called racemic mixture or racemic modification. So, when we define racemic mixture, we say it is a mixture of equimolar quantities of the two enantiomers of an optically active compound, which is optically inactive because optical rotation due to one enantiomer is compensated by the optical rotation of the other enantiomer. And this racemic mixture or racemic modification is denoted as DL, or it is also denoted as plus minus. The next terminology is racemization. Say for example, I start from D-lactic acid. You know, D-lactic acid is an enantiomer, which is an optically active compound. I want to convert that into a racemic mixture by mixing it with equal amount of L-lactic acid. And this process of conversion of an enantiomer into racemic mixture is called racemization. Next, we shall study about these three terminologies, retention, inversion, and racemization. This is the substrate molecule. The attacking agent is Y. In this case, it is observed that this attacking group Y replaces X group in the substrate molecule. If you consider the product A, you observe that the spatial arrangement of different substituents is maintained in the product except for the fact that X group is replaced by Y. And if this happens exclusively, we say that the configuration is retained. On the other hand, If you consider this reaction, here you can make out that when Y attacks the molecule, X is replaced by Y. But the configuration about this particular carbon atom is totally inverted. What I mean is, in the substrate molecule, we have H group projected in, CH3 group is projected out on the left hand side, but in the product side, you can make out that they are present on the right hand side. That's why in this case, we say that the configuration is totally inverted. And in any reaction, if we get both the products A and B in the equal proportions, then we say that the process has undergone racemization. So if compound A is exclusively formed, we say the configuration is retained. If product B is exclusively formed, we say that the configuration is inverted. If both compounds A and B are formed in equal amounts, we say racemization has taken place. So we shall consider the stereochemical aspect in SN2 reaction. The substrate molecule considered here is -2-bromo-octane. Or in other words, we have considered levorotatory 2-bromo-octane. It is subjected to alkaline hydrolysis using sodium hydroxide. And you know that in SN2 mechanism, the nucleophile approaches the carbon atom carrying the halogen from the opposite side in order to reduce the repulsion between electron-rich nucleophile and partially electron-rich bromo group. Because the attack takes place from the opposite side, the configuration is totally inverted. You can make out that the OH group is on the left, whereas in the starting substance, bromo group is on the right. That's why if the starting substance is a levorotatory indicated by negative sign, when you consider the product, it has become dextrorotatory denoted by plus. So in SN2 mechanism, if you are going to start from an optically active substance, you should always have inverted configuration and the product will be the other enantiomer. Let us consider the stereochemical aspect during SN1 mechanism. I have considered alkaline hydrolysis of 2-bromo-butane. You know, in step number 1 of SN1 mechanism, carbon halogen bond should undergo slow heterolysis to form carbocation and halide ion. You know that the carbocation is a planar species. The carbon atom of the carbocation undergoes sp2 hybridization. Because it's a planar species, the nucleophile OH minus can attack either from the left or it can attack from the right. Because of that, we will get 50% of one enantiomer and 50% of the other enantiomer. Or in other words, if you consider the product mixture, it will have 50% of D isomer and 50% of L isomer. Or in other words, what we get is a racemic mixture.